As you will notice that the sequence of the speakers is not accidental, it's deliberate, because you need cooling down and focusing on different things. So let's just say that that great philosopher and believer of nature, the American Henry David Thoreau, in his struggle to live a life of simplicity, had once wondered with utter exasperation why there was such a hullabaloo about the information highway. This was in the 30s, David? Henry David Thoreau, 30s. So Thoreau comments, quote, and I quote, "We are in a great haste to construct a magnetic telegraph from Maine to Texas. How Maine and Texas, or however, Maine and Texas, it may have nothing important to communicate." His skepticism about the need for great haste that has destroyed culturally meaningful ways of living today ranks as reason number one, as the destroyer of ways of life that were once considered healing and sacred. We are lucky that we have an opportunity for words from the horse's mouth, so to say. In this case, Donna Campbell, of Aboriginal origin. She's Aboriginal native of New Zealand, belonging to the Māori tribe, about which we get to read only in the storybooks of hornbirds. So Donna Campbell will tell you what haste does to destroy heritages and sacred spaces.
Donna Campbell is a lecturer in Māori material culture, indigenous textile creation, and Māori art history at the Māori and Pacific Development University of Waikato in Hamilton, New Zealand. Her field of expertise is contemporary weaving in terms of new directions in Māori fiber and avant-garde construction in woven textile. Her recent works include exhibitions involving light and digital imagery. Her work reflects the dynamic of an indigenous artist negotiating the bicultural interface that is New Zealand. We welcome Donna, and she's going to speak to us on design's role in sustaining indigenous communities.
Hey, sorry if I'm yelling. If someone can just, you know, just do that, and then I'll know that I'm yelling into the microphone. I get quite passionate. Yeah, you should all move back, yeah. Smarty. Anyway, I just wanted to add to my introduction. Firstly, I'm very honoured to be a part of this conference. Honoured and absolutely terrified as well. I just really would like to thank Ajante and Ravi and the team for all the tireless work it takes to put something like this together, and for inviting me to be here. So. Just to add to my introduction, I have a Master of Fine Arts from Whitecliffe College of Art and Design in Auckland, New Zealand. I'm a researcher and lecturer in media communication, cultural tourism, and Māori creative practice. I'm also a practitioner, a passionate practitioner of Māori fiber arts and how we can utilise a traditional art form to start to speak with an urban voice, and to talk about issues that are relevant to, particularly, to Māori people in New Zealand. So I just wanted to start. I'm gonna focus on my notes, because if you ask my students in New Zealand, they'll tell you that I'm very prone to rambling. So if I keep my notes, it keeps me on track and I'll stay on time. So anyway. Just a small prayer to start. It's very customary in my culture to kind of just clear the space a little bit to be able to speak into a space. Kawea te muka whenua ki te rangi. Tuia ki te ngira whenua. He aho tapu, he aho mutunga kore. Koia, koia e tipura. So that's a prayer that, in English, which doesn't justify its meaning, but in English, what that prayer is saying is cast the earthly fibre towards the heavens, let it pass through the eye of the spiritual needle, a sacred thread, an eternal thread, And with prayer for its protection, may it continue to excel. The metaphor of the needle and the connection that we have, intangible, to our ancestors and to the future generations to come. My voice will stop shaking in a minute. I'm really nervous. Okay, so where am I? So, my talk today is about traditional and contemporary Māori textile and its significance in the maintenance and preservation of Māori arts, and particularly Māori Indigenous design. The fibre arts do not stand alone, as they are part of the wide realm of Indigenous design, reflecting taumoko, which is a Māori skin art, carving in wood, and traditional Māori fibre. So I'm going to discuss those areas of Māori design, just to kind of contextualise the work that I do. I'm also going to introduce a little bit around my work and the philosophy behind the works that I create. This is what I do. Click, speak, click. Very good. Notes. Okay. So these two images, and a lot of Māori anthropological study of Māori clothing. There's a lot of images like this one here on the left, and of the clothing of the people. But what's sad for us as cultural beings is that there's no names to these people, you know. And so, for us to see our ancestors in that way, and that they're not acknowledged as people, and the lives that they conduct, but they're just kind of posed there so that their clothing can be studied. The one on the right is a doyen of textile fibre, who is my mentor. She just passed away earlier this year. She creates and has taught me to create textile from this traditional art form, moving it and evolving it into the 21st century, still using traditional fibres and methods. Traditional fibres, methods of construction and design. So one of the most fascinating aspects of design in Aotearoa New Zealand is its strong Indigenous voice. The traditional arts of weaving and carving now have an acknowledged international profile due to exhibitions like the well-travelled Te Māori and more recently the Eternal Thread. So I'll talk a little bit about those two exhibitions as well. There she is down there. This is how we create the fibre textile. It's a hand-woven method that doesn't have a frame. Like off loom. These carvings on the right here are by a friend of mine, Lionel Grant. He just built this like fully contemporary new meeting house in a university in Auckland. It's like just completely modern and really, really beautiful. Really new contemporary Māori design. Anyway, so there's my fabulous country down there in comparison to you guys all the way over here. I can't even stop to think about my carbon footprint to arrive here, yeah. But I'm trying to make up for it. Okay. Anyway, so there's New Zealand, and so Māori people. I'm a Māori person. Māori are the first peoples of Aotearoa, and as such, are referred to as the tangata whenua, the first people of the land. Tangata means person, and whenua is land. Tangata whenua. So we're tribal people, sometimes quite very territorial, not sometimes, all the time. Very territorial. We went through a long stage in the late 18th century of war between ourselves, and then the colonial British decided that they would like some of our land, so we went to war with them as well. We didn't win that war, but we did sign a treaty with them. The Treaty of Waitangi was signed in 1840 between the Māori people and the British. And so today, that document is the founding document for the Indigenous people of New Zealand for redress about stolen lands, reclaiming our land, and claiming our space to be Māori people in New Zealand. So we are a country of 4 million people, and Māori make up 15% of that 4 million. So that's kind of the stereotype, that's what it looks like. So Māori philosophy. Māori philosophy is predicated on narratives that pertain that express how the world was created. So that's kind of what everything, how we live in the world, are based on this one really strong narrative and all of the things that encompass that. So how our world was created. So the Māori worldview, the world first began in the dark, between two beings locked in an eternal embrace. These beings begat many children who eventually rose up to separate their parents. This great separation of the earth and sky created the ocean's flora and fauna. The sky we refer to as Rangi Nui, and the earth we refer to as Papatūānuku. The practice of weaving conceptually is perceived as a conduit to bring those two entities together, as they are constantly yearning to come back together. So the traditional fibre arts, they have names, I'll just reel them off, and it doesn't matter if you don't know, if you can't understand them. Raranga is the weaving mat textile, which is what I use, which is what I produce. Everything's made from natural fibre. So raranga, mat textile. Fatu is the process that you saw before of the twining the fabric. Tāniko is another method of twining fabric. And tukutuku, which is in the customary meeting house, which I'll show you in a sec. So these traditional fibre arts are precious gifts that are handed down from the ancestors. These art forms are nurtured, sustained and enriched by contemporary weavers today. So the art forms are very old, and the designs are informed from pre-contact, but there's a lot of contemporary dialogue arising within the practice of not just the fibre arts, but carving, tāmoko, skin art as well. I'll give you another picture while I have a drink. This is one of my friend's paintings. She said, show them in India, show them one of my paintings. Anyway, this is actually a depiction of a story of ours, of a deity or a god called Tane, who climbs the Potama steps, these here, the stairway to heaven, sometimes is perceived as, to bring back the three baskets of knowledge and to the world. So, in the Māori worldview, we're inseparable from the environment. The land owns us rather than we own it. We are guardians of the land and its inhabitants, and we must behave accordingly, taking only what is needed and using it appropriately. We have an unshakable responsibility to conserve, retain, and develop our lands for generations to come. This value system is in direct contrast to the Western attitude to land. The Western ideal is seen as a commodification of land and values. To Māori, the spiritual world is essential to understanding the physical world. So the physical world is represented in our houses. So these are our customary houses, they're communal living spaces. So this house is is called a wharenui. Wharenui means large house, literally. And so the physical world is exemplified in the customary house, in this house. This house is situated in a communal grouping of buildings called a marae. Each building is a communal building, communal eating house, communal sleeping house. And sometimes there's large houses for sleeping and additions of smaller houses. So these houses are used mainly in contemporary society for gatherings of people coming together. This is where we debate. So it's lovely to hear this backwards and forwards. You guys are engaging in. This is where we do it here. Our political stuff, everything, we come together on these places. And it's a place where we can be free of any Western judgment of how we do things. So the marae is the naming of that grouping of buildings. With the wharenui as the focal point, they're a potent cultural signifier on the New Zealand landscape. These are one of the not many physical representations of our people that are left in the Western landscape of New Zealand. So where am I? So core to the Indigenous process. design process is the Wharenui. This is a place where the narratives of our history, our genealogy, our whakapapa, whakapapa is the word for a genealogy. So in the interior of this house reflects connections back to the ancestor. It talks about how all the ancestors are linked together and how we relate to the ancestors that are represented in the house. So we think about these houses as our libraries, holding not just the history of the people within the walls, but also narratives pertaining to what it is to be Māori today. So part of my job at the university, actually, is teaching our young people to decode the messages that are set within the carvings. Within the carvings and within the fibre work inside. So, the houses are often named after a significant ancestor of the tribe, and as such are greeted by name and addressed as a living person. So when you enter the house, so this is a house, usually the mattresses are all laying on the sides, around the back and this way. So mattresses laid down like this. This is actually a house in the Wellington Museum. Sometimes we do use this house to sleep in. So when we enter the house, we are entering the body of the ancestor. The fabric, the whole architecture of this building represents a body. That the tahuhu, or the spine at the back, is the spine. The potoko manawa, that carving at the back there, is the heart of the ancestor. And all of these heke, and with the painted curvilinear patterns, denote the connection of the ancestor, the eponymous ancestor, and how each deity, tribal deity, relates to the main ancestor, as depicted within those curvilinear designs called kōwhaiwhai. So within the patterning is genealogical information. So the artworks within embrace the disciplines of Māori art practice, from the carvings to the fibre works to the architectural structure itself. These visual inscriptions provide the link for us as Māori to our history, to our future, and to our ancestors. The interior fibre works of the Wharenui are firmly in the domain of the feminine, while the carving is firmly in the domain of the masculine. So the artworks within the house are highly gendered. And debated hotly, actually. Yeah, debated hotly in contemporary times. But we won't go there because that's a whole nother 3 hours. What did I want to say? Oh, so the fibre work in this house, there's usually big mats that we make which have symbolism that talks about tribal areas. If you can look at the back there, you can see the step-like design in between those two carvings there. Can you see that? Just seeing if you're all awake. Can you see that? Yeah. Okay. Just seeing if you're awake. That's the fibre panels in between each carving. Those fibre panels deepen the conversation or the dialogue between the two ancestors depicted on each side of them. So every fibre panel broadens the dialogue for people to read. A lot of this messaging is lost to our urbanised young people. And so we go back to the houses, we go back to the areas, and we decode and work out what these carvers were trying to tell us, or what the ancestors were trying to tell us. So we can consider these to be narratives of history, narratives of inscription. And when we think about Māori cosmology, which deeply informs all of this artwork, Māori cosmology locate past time to the front, while the future lies behind one. This notion is a direct reversal of European usage, and the idea that the ancestors are not memories, but ever-present, guiding and informing. So these carvings are a really good example of that frontal nature. So all the carvings are kind of deep, two-dimensional carvings, which my work reflects that too. So the next sort of little area of design I wanted to talk about is tā moko. We never call it tattoo. Tā moko is the true description of the practice. So the art of tāmuku is a form of carving on the skin. The pre-contact, the skin was cut open by a tapping uhi, and then ink was placed and poured into the skin. So, you know, carving. So the Māori art of tāmuku has been passed down from one generation to the next for hundreds of years. It is believed that tāmuku preceded wood carving as the first form of Māori carving. And the term carving does much to indicate the pain endured to receive a traditional muku. All the symbols have meaning, usually a tribal link, that tells background and stories of the wearer. Muku is a visual language that connects the wearer to their whakapapa or genealogy. A muku on the face is the ultimate statement of one's identity as Māori. The head is believed to be the most sacred part of our body. To wear a muku on the face is to bear an undeniable declaration of who you are. Women wear muku, as you can see there, just here. There's some contemporary, you know, in this world of contemporary body modification. There's a lot of images or a lot of people that are wearing this kind of marking in completely inappropriate places. It's unreal. You know, like they just take one element of this. Just take one element and just put it over there. I've seen a picture of this guy in LA, like he's an LA celebrity type person who just goes around getting covered with whatever culture he likes, and he has a female muku just there. So, you know, misappropriation of Indigenous design is really something really critical that we all have to be aware of. So muku for women are worn on the chin as well as on the forehead. And down here. But in contemporary times, many Māori people are rediscovering their heritage and many are turning to the art of muku. Tāmuku continues to mean what it has always meant, even though in contemporary times, it's being worn, when it's worn by Māori, it's tāmuku. So the practitioners who do this stuff, when they put, there's a debate going around about if it's worn by a non-Māori person, is it still tāmuku? And their debate, which we're all engaged in actually, as practitioners in New Zealand, we've come to this point where if it's worn by non-Māori, it becomes something called kirituhi, which means drawing on the skin. So it doesn't have a genealogical link for that person that's wearing it. So it's redefined as something different from this, from a Māori person wearing this. I was just going to go off on this big tangent then. See, notes are good. Notes are really good. So it continues to mean what it has always meant, a symbol of integrity, Māori identity and prestige, as well as a reflection of one's ancestry and personal history. The lines tell the story of the wearer's life. The left side represents the father's lineage and the right the mother's. So this is what's happening today. It's one of my grandmothers. In Māori Dim, we have lots of grandmothers, grandfathers, uncles, aunties. So, where am I going now? Okay, so cultural exchange through exhibition and artist residencies and conferences such as this kind of thing have been an important way for Māori to maintain integrity, ownership and agency of Indigenous Māori design. So one of the things that I teach is about intellectual property in terms of Indigenous design. How do we maintain integrity and also agency, you know, which is really key to us as Māori designers. We need agency and to maintain integrity, actually. These are a couple of images from the Te Māori exhibition. It opened in 1984 at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, and it travelled around. It went to St. Louis Art Museum and the de Jong Museum of Fine Arts in San Francisco and the Field Museum of Natural History in the States. So this exhibition really brought Māori art to the world. It was mainly carving. There was no fibre work in this exhibition. So the travelling showing and opening of the show was a critical time for the understanding by museums to the relationships that Māori people have with their cultural objects. So for us to have our cultural objects within a museum, they're not planted there and then left by themselves. We consider them to still have life force and that we're connected to them. The Te Māori exhibition opened with a traditional dawn ceremony with customary rituals performed by elders of the tribes of Aotearoa. This exhibition contained predominantly carved taonga. Taonga is artworks of wood, bone and stone. Māori taonga or artefacts are considered to contain a Māori or a life force, a spiritual power. Traditional rituals were carried out at the opening of each of the showings, each of the openings around the US. And so every opening had a traditional opening accompanied by elders. The word taonga is artworks, but so the word taonga describes a sacred dimension to our works of art. They are not just secular objects that are detached from our social history. Rather, they represent a link between our ancestors and us, between the past and the present, between the dead and the living. Performance of these customary rituals in the openings, although commonplace in Aotearoa, were extraordinary for the curators and visitors to the museum, to the museums and exhibitions. Because of the impact of Te Māori overseas, these practices are now typical when exhibitions open overseas. International art venues now realise that Māori have distinctive bonds with their taonga, with their art, and that the human element is a necessary part of this visual culture and intrinsically linked with these objects. I think oftentimes that when artefacts or objects, I really don't like those two words, but I'll use them, when artefacts are shown separate from the people of a culture, they become a static image of what this culture is all about. So we're deeply connected with these taonga and we need to be with them wherever when they travel as an expression of that connection. The next significant exhibition I wanted to talk about is an exhibition 20 years later of fibre art that's kind of in response to the carving, to all the carvings that were sent in 1984 to the US. So this exhibition, The Eternal Thread, an exhibition of contemporary and traditional Māori textiles that travelled its home country and then went on to travel the west coast of North America, culminating at the Native Reservation Warm Springs Museum. The Eternal Thread exhibition not only travelled taonga or works of art, these works of art were accompanied by practicing artists who could engage with the local people and reveal how some of the taonga in the exhibition were created. So I was a co-curator of this exhibition. The key thing for us was that we had people demonstrating how some of the artworks are made, rather than just having Māori people going and doing the opening, doing the ritual and then disappearing. So what we wanted to have was a real meaningful exchange with the people that visited the museum, and to open the broad, to open up what we were actually, what these taonga or what these fibre works meant to us. So these are some of the garments that, so there were 120 garments that went in this exhibition. So it's like the biggest collection of fibre that has ever left the shores of New Zealand. Now some of these garments are really, really old. And so, and the creation of these kinds of garments, there's a real connection with the maker. Some people did not want to send their garments overseas. So we had to source work from people who were willing to let them go. Okay, I'll let that go for a year. Actually, the exhibition travelled for 2 years. You know, but we had to negotiate with the makers to let these things out of their lives for 2 years. And it was quite... yeah, it was really quite moving, the relationship, to see that relationship. Here we are practicing and having an exchange with the Native Americans that were where we were, demonstrating weaving and exposing our art form to whoever came to visit. Weavers, carvers, this big this big panel, well actually it's a PO, but this big panel was a collaborative piece between a Native American carver and my friend Ray. And tāmoko practice. People get really inspired when they see tāmoko in action. We ended up having a couple of sessions to place skin art on two Native American grandmothers, who the art form of the Siletz people is three lines like that for grandmothers. And they hadn't practiced that. There was no wearing of that. It was just about lost, but they knew about it. And so through this exchange, Mark got to do two nannies, grandmothers, with that mark there. They couldn't finish them in this exhibition because we ran out of time. They couldn't finish the artwork. So those two nannies came to New Zealand the next year to complete their work. It was beautiful. I don't know why I don't have a picture. It doesn't sound right. I'm not using my Māori terminology. It doesn't sound quite right. Okay, so when this exhibition left the shores of Aotearoa, it went directly to San Francisco, to the Yuba Buena Centre, and there was a massive opening. So this is a traditional waka. It didn't sail all the way from New Zealand. I could have told you that, and you probably would have believed me. I should have told you that. No, it came on a plane, but it's it was a kind of a symbolic arrival. The Māori arriving to the land of the Siletz people in San Francisco. Oh, the Ohlone people, sorry, in San Francisco. So it was really, really meaningful for us to be welcomed by the first people of the nation. It was really important to us that they gave us permission to be there. So that was a really, really moving experience for all of us. Okay, so practitioners of the fibre arts often work in a really collective way. So these garments are usually made in a collective way. It's a long, laborious process. And so trying to make one of these things individually takes a long, 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 long time. So you need a lot of help, a lot of support. And so what we do in New Zealand, as a way of knowledge transmission, is to bring people together in environments where total immersion is possible. So we're on the marae, yeah? So we come together and we work together to create whatever it is that we're working on. So just up the top there, we're just making a large mat. These mats are usually 5 to 10 centimetres long, 5 centimetres wide, and they adorn the interior of the houses. They have symbology that's relevant to the area, usually. I see I'm rambling, now I've lost my place. Okay, so these, you could call them total immersion workshops, but we call them wānanga. And we come together and that's all we do for 5 to 6 days, is just work on projects together. This is a traditional way of learning any discipline that is associated with Māori culture. The learning occurs from teacher to student and student to teacher. In this way, the students are exposed to many experts in the area, and the experts in the area are exposed to new ways of doing things, or they're exposed to what other practitioners are doing. This keeps the art form dynamic and evolving and shifting. So these type of learning environments allow everyone to work at their own pace and allow access to the experts and elders in their fields. The nurturing of the arts is fulfilled at these events, and discussion is encouraged as to how to move forward in terms of preserving but also evolving these design forms without losing integrity within the creation of these taonga. So I just wanted to show you a few images of a traditional dyeing process that we use. So here the stone, there's round stones. There's actually feminine and negative, there's female and male stones. So when we go to collect stones, we only put female stones on the fire. Female stones have small holes in them, really tiny small holes. Male stones are very solid. So we don't put male stones in the fire because they tend to explode when they get really hot. Does that sound right? And so the female stones just soak up the heat. So these fires are built the night before, big fire, put the stones on, the stones are heated, then they're picked up. They have to be picked up by two people at a time because it's impossible. We use willow sticks that we've prepared the night before. This is usually a workshop that will go for 6 to 7 days. Willow sticks, because willow doesn't catch fire, so we soak them at night. It doesn't catch fire when we pick the stones up. So the stones are then taken over to a kumite, or a wooden vessel. And inside this wooden vessel is water and bark, native tree bark. So we have different trees for different colours. Okay? The stones are put into the water, it starts to bubbly bulb, like a little witch's cauldron. So the heat has to be controlled. The stones are dropping in, and someone has to take them out at the other end. They have to be constantly replaced to keep the temperature even, to release the dyes from the bark. So that's boiled and then drained off. This is how we dye our fibre, the fibre to make the cloaks that you were looking at before. And that's what we end up with. All right, so I just wanted to, I'm really aware of the time. So I just wanted to show you a little bit about the work that I do. In terms of contemporary traditional fibre, and my artistic practice is grounded within a traditional way of doing things. Traditional process that involves karakia, which is prayer and thankfulness, creating the space to be able to make new work, and being mindful of conservation practices. So work initially, when I first started to learn to weave, this is usually where people start, making baskets like that. This is a flax plant that we use. Now this plant is, when Māori first arrived in New Zealand, you know, our history is that we came on large waka, large boats, like the one you saw in the harbour, San Francisco, exactly like that, from Rangiatia, a central place in Polynesia, in 700 AD. When we arrived, we had our own technologies, but the place was much colder than where we had come from. So we had to adapt to a different climate. And so we had to find some sustenance through different plants. Okay, so harakeke, or this flax plant, was discovered. From this plant, we get clothing, shelter, fishing instruments, cultivation instruments, medicine, baskets for all manner of things, and clothing, just from this one plant. It's amazing. I really think that if my ancestors didn't discover this plant, I wouldn't be standing here. I wouldn't be. So everything. Oh, that's my mum, by the way. She's in there. Thought I'd bring her to India. So from making baskets like this, my work evolved into thinking about these kete, or these baskets, are containers of culture. How can we, as practitioners, excite our young people to take up this craft? Because, you know, it's kind of considered as, oh, that's what old ladies do. That's just what old ladies do. It's got no relevance to me. I'm urban. I'm hip. I'm cool, right? So it's like, okay, so how do we get our young people excited about this art form as a way that they can use it for their own expression? Now, I'm not saying that I'm responsible for generating excitement around this for our urban youth, but I have made slight inroads, and so this is the kind of work that I make, I think. Oh, yeah. So when I think about the basket as a container, and the container of history, narrative and culture, then it just goes to the next kind of step for me is the body as container. I've developed this theory around the cultural body and how it navigates spaces, and in terms of how the cultural body navigates Western space, given that Māori people are only 50% of the population in our own country. Also, how the cultural body relates to its environment. In the Māori worldview, we have many cultural bodies, Rangi Nui the Sky Father and Papatūānuku the Earth Mother. How we relate to the ocean is another cultural body, and it's very different to the Western way of relating to the ocean. So, I started to create bodies. And then comparing this notion of the Western idea of beauty and the Polynesian idea of beauty. And how can we free our young people from the constraints of trying to squeeze into an ideal Western body? You know, Polynesians, we're quite, ta-da. You know, we're not like size 8. We're just not. We're not. Yes, healthy. That's what we are. We're quite healthy. And so, you know, it's about the work tries to talk about what is the ideal that we want, you know, and why do we want it? And there's beauty in the real body, okay? What's this one? Oh, yeah. So this is a mannequin body. So, you know, I'm trying to compare these kinds of ideas or notions that we have about not being good enough, you know. For Māori in New Zealand, we're all about empowering ourselves so that we do have a voice. One of the major things that really struck me working with students here is how confident you all are. You know, and that's just so refreshing to me. Our Māori students in New Zealand are very shy. You know, they're not confident. They don't own the space. So we're trying to teach that. Okay. Oh, see, I'm not looking at my notes, so I'm going off track. Anyway, so from making the body or creating the body, my next little journey or experiment was encasing the body. So all of this, just to remind you in case you're getting tired out there, all of these garments are made from the mat textile of a basket, okay, from the flax plant with natural processes. So once they're done with, they can just go back to the earth. So this is a colonial dress. It talks about the limits of colonialism. It's impossible to wear. It has wire in it, so you can't sit down, you can't fit through doorways, but it kind of looks good. So it's sort of that seductiveness of the colonial world, you know, but really, it's dangerous and limiting. So there's another picture of that. So it's lined, you know, it has all these things. Just back before, I don't know how to go backwards, so I'll have to say it. You saw that mannequin body, it was yellow, bright yellow? Okay, so that's a particular plant. It's not that big green one that we saw before. And there's a little basket down in the exhibition area, little basket. Yeah, so this is made from pingao. It's a golden sand sedge that holds the shoreline together. We have these mad people in Aotearoa. We have these long beaches, long, long beaches. And then we have these mad people in Aotearoa with cars, you know, with those big wheels on. And they just go burning all over the foreshore. And this little plant, this little golden sand sedge, is what we just keep replanting that, and that's what holds the foreshore together, holds the beach together. Anyway, so that's two little garments on the catwalk. These are performance students in my school. I make lots of garments, and you know, they're always knocking on my door saying, "Oh, have you got something? Have you got something for me to wear in my performance?" So usually, if they buy me morning tea or lunch, you know, they can look in my boxes of stuff and take them and use them in whatever way is appropriate. So, by the way, in the School of Māori and Pacific Development, we teach contemporary dance and traditional dance. And so, and students are encouraged to create their own garments, but it's easier to come and see me. What else? Oh, this garment was in the Eternal Thread exhibition. It was purchased by the Halliford Museum of Art and Design in Oregon, Salem, Oregon. It's a, as you can see, a three-piece garment, and it this, the pattern there is called Karuhapuku. And the pattern symbolises a coastal tribal area. Karuhapuku is a flounder. We have flounder, a New Zealand flat fish with two eyes on the top. Do you have them in India? Two eyes on the top. So this diamond pattern is a symbolism for those fish. And it talks, and the pattern symbolises abundance, abundance in coastal area. It's a really difficult pattern to master, and so I've been practicing it for years, trying to get it really perfect. So when I got it perfect in a basket, I could allow myself to make a garment. I was going to say something, but I forgot. This little number is called party dress. And it's one of those dresses where you don't need to sit down. You can't really sit down because it's got this thing. But this dress, you don't need to sit down. You can just swan around and, you know, why is my glass empty kind of dress. See, the women in this room get it. You guys get it. Yeah, so it's another, like, you know, trying to think about what is it that we're looking, that our young people are looking at fashion and thinking that they're not good enough. So I have critique from my colleagues about, because I think I'm critiquing the size 8 Western body. I think that's what I'm doing. But some of my colleagues think that I'm perpetuating it. So we have this dialogue. See, I love debate. I loved that debate just before. So we have this debate about, you know, what am I doing? I think they're wrong, they think I'm wrong. But we just can disagree with each other. That's okay. So, and taking this matte textile, moving it in directions where young people, where they haven't seen it before, they can do this too, you know, or they can use it in ways that will make that something relevant to them, something urban to them that matters. Oh, this is how I construct. I just thought you'd like, as makers, you know, we always, as makers, it's good to see something being made. So everything's constructed in three dimensions. This garment is, you can sit down in this one. This is, I put this up here because it just won this really grand prize. And it was in a fashion show that had every grouping in it, like bridal wear, street wear, day wear, you know. So it was kind of like a conservative fashion show. It wasn't a wearable art show or anything. This, I put this in as in a section called organic glam. Organic glam. So it was about, the criteria was to make a garment that was completely organic. It had to be 99.9% organic, and had to be able to go back into the earth. So I rejigged some baskets that I had at home, rejigged them, made some more textile, added it together, and da-da, I got a 99.9% recyclable garment. And it took out the Supreme Award, which I think is amazing for, this is the conversation that's happening in Aotearoa, New Zealand today, that work like this can win like a conservative fashion show. I think that's really great. So what that tells me is there is an understanding of the construction of this kind of textile, and there's an understanding of the significance of it for New Zealand design. Okay, making. I love plaiting. I can just plait for ages and ages. Oh, this is the newest garment. So before, you know, you saw some cloaks with feathers on them. This is kind of a little twist, encasing the legs in feathers and woven corset. And it's kind of like a bit naughty to make a garment that is encasing the legs in feathers in terms of how our relationship with cloaks. So it's kind of, yeah, a bit naughty. But that's all right. Oh, and so this garment is based on Kuru Naituku, you might have seen that before, who is a bird woman creature from Māori narrative. So I'm constantly using our stories to inspire the work that I make. And I think, oh yeah, okay, just a few more. And so these are more object-based works. These are a reclaimed kite series. So these are baskets that have been in use and discarded. And what I've been doing is cutting them open and reforming them into body forms. It's really not kind of cool to cut weaving open, but I was in my MFA, I think my second year of my MFA, and you know, I just wanted to really push the boundaries of tradition. I was trying to think about how does tradition limit us, and how can we evolve it with integrity. So taking these baskets apart to me was like creating new ways of seeing, new ways of seeing the discarded, paying homage to the knowledge that was in this discarded object, but also honouring the ageing process. So I made a whole series of these. This is an installation in the Waikato Museum in Hamilton, and that's my quote at the back. So a kite or a basket, even when empty, contains a whakapapa. A whakapapa or historic kōrero in the construction and symbology of pattern. So even though I've shifted the format of the symbology, it's still containing the same history, but it's added on another dialogue. These open weave baskets are baskets that are used mainly for cultivation or for gathering seafood. So when they are a basket, you know, you can take them into the ocean, gather all your kina, put them in the basket. Do you guys have kina? Do you know what kina is? Sea urchins. I was speaking to someone here who knew what they were. Huh?
Sea urchin.
Yeah, so you have to dive for those, and you can put them in your bag. When you come out, all the water just drains out of the spaces. And it was very great of all my friends to give me their old baskets. So, in conclusion, that's my work. That's my most recent work anyway. But in conclusion, when we think about exhibitions like The Eternal Thread, like Te Māori, and artistic cultural exchange. Really, they're things that give meaning to the cultural exchange between Indigenous peoples. When we do it through our artworks and the things that we're making, it adds a deeper layer to expression and how we think about designing and how we think about creating. Often there's real similarities, and often there's dissimilarities or diversity, and that's what we can celebrate, both of those things. So these cultural exchanges, such as those exhibitions, have forged new relationships with several artists travelling backwards and forwards to Aotearoa and out. And one of the most recent results of these endeavours was the creation of an artist residency at the University of Hawaii at Manoa on the island of Oahu. I took up that residency just before I came here, actually. I just finished it. It was a two-month residency, and it allowed me to work directly with the students of Hawaiian descent, just students of Hawaiian descent, to create an exhibition of contemporary garments to open at the Bishop Museum next week. This cultural exchange had been created particularly for a Māori Hawaiian exchange, so it's really in Polynesia. These types of residencies, particularly this one, these things really encourage a growth of ideas and creative practice that may not have been envisaged before when working in your own familiar environment. Cultural artistic exchange brings people together in a sharing relationship that honours diversity. Time-honoured wisdom can be shared, as more often than not, these perspectives are based in the sustainability of the environment and of the people. And a lot of time, Western practice is not concerned with those areas. So customary ways of working in the arts are maintained and nurtured, while contemporary practice can be enriched. Opportunities arise to engage and bring different ideas together based in a strong cultural aesthetic where Indigenous knowledge is acknowledged and privileged. We need to ensure that things of this nature are sustained, as they are an investment in cultural capital, as an expression of identity and resilience, and the building of these trustful relationships ensure our survival as arts practitioners, ritualists and survivors of the colonial process. That's my talk, but I've just got, don't move, I've just got a little song. It's actually not a little song, it's a very deep, profound song about how we perceive the Harakeke plant to be and how we relate to it as a family. Hūtia te rito, hūtia te rito te Harakeke. Kei he te koma ko e ko, ki mai koe ki aha. He aha te mea nui, he aha te mea nui o te ao. Māku e ki atu, he tangata, he tangata, he tangata, hey. That song is about, oh, you don't need to, oh, but thank you. That rendition is, the question is asked, oh, it says, don't pull the leaf from the inside of the harakeke, of the flax plant, because where will the kōmako sing? Where, how will it feed? And it relates to people in the world. And then it says in the rendition, you ask me a question, what is the most important thing in the world? And my answer to you is, it's people, it is people, it is people. Kia ora mai tātou, thank you very much. Oh, namaste.